Good afternoon, dear friends. We're happy to welcome you in the event of the International Institute of World Policy, and we will discuss the assistance of the European Union in reforming Ukraine's civil security sector. Mr. Lytvynenko and Yevhen Yenin are on approach. They will join us later, and we will start. So today, we will present a document for discussion. You had the possibility to review it. This is about consultancy, the European Union advisory mission. Very briefly, I will describe the project and explain why we have this very event at this very moment. So 2 years ago, the mission started its work here in Ukraine immediately after the aggression in Crimea. Mr. Dyshchytsa expressed the idea that this mission could be dispatched in Ukraine. This is almost 2 years of our work in Ukraine. The mission had extended considerably, and now the mandate is extended. The Institute of World Policy is part of the WASCAP program implemented on the Horizon 2020 framework, and the objective is to accumulate EU effort in this area. So our paper is focused on the EU activities. The review mainly was review and research was done in autumn. Then it was supplemented with interviews, and later the latest updates were added. So our colleagues are here to present this in more detail. So the key outcomes of this paper are as follows. Since the moment when the mission was dispatched in Ukraine, it has found its field of activity, its niche for activity. So the mission now clearly understands what it wishes to do, what partners, upon what partners it wishes to be focused. Also, Ukrainian partners mentioned that this mission is an important direct channel of communication with Brussels, and also mentioned the high professional level of the mission advisors. When we carried out similar analysis in a year ago, we marked those partners who worked with the mission more actively, and the same partners of the mission who started to work very proactively with the mission, they had preserved the pace and intensity of cooperation till now, despite the fact that director of the mission had changed in Ukraine. The overall objective of the mission, reforming Ukraine's civilian security sector, is rather comprehensive, and this is a rather complicated mission. On the one hand, That's very good. On the other hand, Ukrainian partners, not all Ukrainian partners, were ready to accept advisory support that was provided by our experts. Now, I would like to give the floor to our speakers, and I would like to give the floor to Mr. Oleksandr Lytvynenko, Deputy Secretary of the National Security and Defense Council in Ukraine, who will describe in more detail the stage in reform in Ukraine's civil security sector. Thank you very much. I would like to thank to the Institute of World Policy for invitation for the organization of this event, and I would like to point out several aspects of our reforms. First of all the reforms carried out here in Ukraine are being implemented in the times of war, today's subversary actions in Balaklava once again prove this. We have to keep in mind this situation of the continuous fighting and warfare at the borders of our country, and the situation of peace in Kyiv does not mean that servicemen from the armed forces, emergency service, national guards, border guards, that they do not participate in military actions. The second, in such times of trouble, sometimes it's easier to implement some more radical reforms and do some more important things than you can achieve in the times of everyday routine. We are very grateful to our partners, to the European Union, to the United States, to the United Kingdom, who provide support to this project, to the National Security and Defense Council of Ukraine very fruitfully cooperates with the mission, and I would like to thank to the mission for participation in drafting of the law on national security, which today was submitted to the presidential administration at its final stage of readiness. I think then the project is very important. It allowed to develop good cooperation tools, good cooperation mechanisms with our Western partners, which allowed us to adapt European realities and European standards to Ukrainian conditions, since it is based on our Ukrainian realities. During the 2 years of the mission's work, it had covered a long path, and maybe my colleagues will explain this in more detail, but in my opinion, it becomes more and more practical. It tries to resolve more and more specific issues and problems in training, in upgrading of police servicemen, of Ukrainian border guards, of Ukrainian enforcement officers who receive training and knowledge, which is so much needed today. Also, the mission very actively participated in reforming of the security service of Ukraine, which the day after tomorrow will mark its 25th anniversary. And I think this time today is the right moment for intermediary assessment of our work. We have done enough and we have good prospects for further work. Thank you, Oleksandr, for this intervention. Now I would like to give the floor to Ms. Anastasia Dieieva, Deputy Minister of Interior of Ukraine. Anastasia, my question to you, observing the work of the mission, and I understand that the National Police is in the focus of the mission's work. Please mention what we would not get if the mission were not to be deployed here. Thank you for this opportunity. The ministry is responsible for the establishing and reforming of the national police, and in our cooperation with the mission, the following aspect is very important. We should forget about firefighting approach, but to form the ground for systemic work, sustainable procedures based on the experience of other countries. And the mission is able to provide advice how the procedures, how the process should take place in the Ministry of the Interior, in the police, etc. And I agree with you that in 2015, the European Advisory Mission and ourselves were quite confused how we can involve all human resources, expert resources, and how we can organize our work better. But upon these 2 years, having had many discussions, many round tables, and having established very good bilateral cooperation with the Canadian government, with the governments of European countries, we are very grateful to the mission, which took responsibility for providing this platform for communication. And this allows us not to duplicate work and advice received from international partners, and to allocate available resources rationally. In our latest achievements in implementation of the association agreement, Ms. Klimpuš-Tsentsadze mentioned that communication is important, and we should be able to present adequately our progress, our achievements to our international partners, and this mission allows us to do this. Thus, we were able to present our intelligence-led policy. We work very proactively in community policing area, in public control or public order control, and cooperation with the police forces in course of the massive public rallies. Very soon, the European Commission and the EUAM will cooperate with us in this work. Quite often, it's very difficult to communicate on the issue, for example, on intelligence-led policy, but we have to establish good analytical resource for the police in order to be able to predict, to develop response scenarios, etc. That's why I'm very grateful to our advisors for this constructive and very practical approach, and I believe we will continue this very useful cooperation. The logo of the mission, the slogan of the mission, and is advising for trust. And how do you implement this? Yesterday, I received a document from training from a survey showing that the level of trust had grown from 43% up to 54%, which trust to police, which shows that the trust is growing slowly, and the level of trust remains stable in society, and very soon we hope to witness positive growth. Now, I would like to ask the question to the mission representatives, to Mr. Udo Mueller, European Union Advisory Mission Head of Operations. Thank you. What do you think about your mission's work here in Ukraine?
At first, allow me to say thank you. I'm thinking the same way as my speakers before. I think we are positive and we will be successful and we are on the right way. I think a lot of things changed, but at first allow me to raise our deep thanks to the organizers that we have the chance to be here and also give some of our views of the development of the mission. We think it could be really helpful as well. The second, if it comes to the development of the mission, and maybe I'm also can witness personally, because I'm here since September, from the early beginning of the mission, and I can say something, what is the development about? And back to the logo, advisory for trust, to call in a mission and let us know that we should help for the development of the civil society, civil security sector is one thing, but to interact with human beings is the next thing. So that means in the early beginning, it was for us also really difficult at first, based on our mandate, to, let me say, to be very practical. Second, to get the trust of our colleagues here in Ukraine, that they can rely on us, that we are not here only for, let me say, few days and then will disappear or something like that. No, I think in the beginning it was really a question of how human beings can find the common sense, the common objectives, and how they would like to work together. And this, I think that's improved dramatically, and it is a door opener for the whole progress in the development of the security sector, because we are working together as human beings, based on clear strategies, based on a clear vision, based on that what the European Union as a whole can deliver and can support to the whole reform process here in Ukraine. As a mission, we are only part of the European support, and it was also mentioned the Commission, of course, the Council. The European Union is really committed for the whole reform process, and you know it as well. That is not only money, it is also committed to the, let me say, to the sense and the outcome of a reform process. In this regard, I think the mission itself made also, in very close cooperation with our counterparts, we made also our experience, what is expected from our colleagues here in Ukraine. And to give advices is one thing, but to make it practical, practical and make it, let me say, sustainable is another thing. And after 1 year, or close to 1 year, we went for the review of the mandate, and the process on this was also very deep initiated by our counterparts on the political level, on the strategic level, on tactical level. And also internally we made our assessment and said, maybe we can be more professional, we can be more, can deep worker, and can deep more with regard to the sustainability, but then we need an additional mandate. And based on the political, high political discussion where the Ukrainians are very deep involved, and the European member states, with the contribution from the ground, from us to Brussels, it was possible to modify the mandate. And I think this modification of the mandate is a serious step forward to be more efficient and more work more on sustainability for the whole reform process. I only can underpin what my colleague said. It is not only to go for advisory, you can do it in this or this way, that's one thing, but to show it and train and give equipment support so that you can do it what it is advised. I think that was a major key for the success, for the beginning of the success of this mission. And we are really grateful that this process could be set up in very close cooperation with our partners here, but also in very close cooperation with our partners, our counterparts in Brussels. We always find open ears for this kind of amendments, and we are really confident that this way can be go ahead with even more success. Allow me also to say thank you. I heard it very well, and I will say to my colleagues as well, of course, we believe in our professionalism. And if you now observing that, that is the best what you can do. So I would like to give it back to my colleagues as well. And allow me also to say the whole reform process where we are engaged as a mission, it is not only a reform process engaged by internationals. It is also, and here are a lot of our national colleagues involved with high expertise, with all this knowledge out of the organizations. I think we were not able to be successful in this way, because we know our European standard, but how it can apply in Ukraine, it is absolutely different. And that sometimes gives a little bit of step back, but on the other hand, it opened our eyes as well for the whole reform process. And that is a point, let me say, of no return. As long as our national colleagues will work with us together, as long as we will work in this very cooperative sense, I think I'm very satisfied and we will be successful.
Thank you, Mr. Mueller. I would like to ask you just a couple of specifying questions. Very briefly, just in your opinion, what is the key achievement of the mission? Just if we name one, and key obstacle? That's one question. Another question is, I know that we are expecting the prolongation of the mandate. Which changes in the operation plan shall we expect from the mission?
I think the, let me say, the key achievements. Allow me to look to the left. There's one guy who worked with us very, very close to go for the, let me say, for the increased trust in police in regions, or in cities and in regions. It is a Zambia model, but also in close cooperation with our international colleagues who worked on the patrol police project in the big cities. I think this together opened, let me say, the mind internally for the police that it could be and it must be a service-oriented entity. And I think now we can say the Zambia implementation gives 4, 5, 6 million people more success to a service-oriented police. I think that is the first step I would like to say. The second, we are not always a police mission, even I'm a police colleague, but nevertheless we are working in the whole security sector. And I think the second achievement is that we were able to contribute to the construction within the field of corruption, anti-corruption, with our full expertise. I think we did a lot of things together with regard to training, strategy development, open ears and open mind to other countries, study visits and something like that. So I think this whole infrastructure in fight corruption was could be very much influenced from us as well. And allow me to look to the right, to my colleague here, from the NSDC. We were very grateful that the NSDC took the lead for the new law, or draft law, let me say, or concept on national security, because this law, if it comes, if it will apply, will give a clear delineation between the ministries, and that will make a lot of things easier to develop strategies, to develop concepts, because it is a change from a, let me say, from an organization which is always focusing on institution. Now that there will be a change to focus on the service for the people, I think that is will be essential.
As for the mandate, the new operation plan, any changes?
Yeah, that was not by purpose that I handed over the microphone, because the change of the mandate, that will of course very much in, depend by the high level political discussion. What we expect, what we see, and that is also experience we made. Of course, we are very much engaged in regions, not only by the regional presence, but also by our mobile teams. So I think to have this eye and the cooperation in regions is one thing for us, and also to bring it up to the strategic level to have an impact on that. If there will be a change on the mandate, that is right now under discussion. I can't say what will be the outcome, but we are sure that the link from the strategic level to the regional level is one of the essential key points to be successful.
Thank you very much. Я прошу до слова заступника генерального.
I would like to give the microphone to Mr. Yevhen Yenin, Deputy Prosecutor General of Ukraine. So my question to you, my observations of the mission work is as follows, that from autumn last year, the cooperation had reached very intensive level. Although the mission has had been working in Ukraine for 1 year by that moment, why this happened that you not immediately started to cooperate with the mission? Thank you for the question. I will divide my answer into two parts. First, I will describe our cooperation with the mission, our joint work, and the first outputs. And then I will describe the expectations and plans which we will implement jointly with the mission. So the first question, what is the output of our cooperation with the mission? When I came to the Prosecutor General office, we found out that there were 8,000 pages of very important documents, materials, which had to be translated for translation. This was a huge, huge amount of work, and our cooperation with the mission, Mr. Lanchinsk, especially Mr. Lanchinskas, acted very efficiently, and we had installed Trada's translation memory tool, and it speed up the speeded translation. And as of now, all the documents which arrive, we are able to translate very quickly and review the issue within 2-3 weeks. And this allows to speed up investigations in many cases. Then we are very grateful to the mission for organization of round tables, for trainings, for participation of the mission in the tests and selection of prosecutors at the regional level, up to 70% of vacancies of local prosecutors are now filled due to those selection procedure and testing which we had. Also, we are very grateful to the mission for that communication platform which they provided. Of course, we have our own internal home assignments, but the communication is needed not just with the partners, but with broad public domestically, here internally, to let people know what we are doing and what we wish to do. We project for more. Next week, Prosecutor General will attend Brussels. He will meet with the EU leadership, and we will discuss our future EUAM cooperation. For example, I think my colleagues from other law enforcement agencies will help me, but I mean the electronic database of criminal investigations. Here, electronic documentation is needed. Quite often, the documents disappear or are damaged due to weather or physical reasons, and this will also eliminate some corruption risks. No human contacts will be needed, no physical contacts will be needed, everything will be done electronically. The register of pre-court investigations allowed to resolve the corruption problem partially, but we need to do next step. This requires a big amount of work because we are speaking here about unification of different computer platforms, which requires some work, and this may take up to several years. Also, we hope to continue our cooperation in the area of practical trainings. We are specifically interested in trainings on human trafficking and cybercrime. And when the prosecutor's office deals with such investigations, and specifically we are responsible for just judiciary oversight over investigation, so we need to know the practice of other countries. We are very grateful to the mission. Also, I would like to mention that sometimes subjective factors, specifically human contacts, are very important in our work. I'm very grateful to the mission for all this cooperation between people. Thank you very much.
Now I would like to give the floor to Yevhen Zakharov, director of the Kharkiv Human Rights Group. And this is the only representative of a non-governmental organization today. And he is the member of the organization who work with this mission locally in Kharkiv, where the mission is present. Yevgeny, we have a question to you. What trends, what changes do you see in Kharkiv, and what should be the priority of work of the mission in the regions? Thank you for your for this invitation, for the organization of this event, and for the opportunity to speak. Maybe I will answer your question at the end of my speech. I would like to say that I am really satisfied because I cooperated with the mission for a long time, and for me it is really important that first that the mission now is not only provide advice, but also is engaged in practical activity and project activity. And this is really important because the mission is our ally, and the mission clearly understand the priority in the activity of law enforcement bodies, and they clearly understand how to reach the balance between security and human rights protection. And this balance in Ukraine is shifted towards security, and human rights are violated by law enforcers really gravely. And the mission sees this, and they provide consultations and advice, and this is the institution that works with law enforcement bodies directly, and this is really important. I took part in a cooperation to build new territorial units of national police in rural areas and in small towns, and also worked on the strategy of development of national police and law enforcement bodies to reform criminal legislation. And I feel friendly support and clear understanding of our problems. I would like to say that the role of the mission today is increasing. We should say that as there were some delays in reforming, I mean in National Police and the Ministry of Internal Affairs, and there were some objective and subjective reasons for this. It happened so that in October last year, the Ministry of Internal Affairs had serious problems. They were understaffed 40%, and attestation, many problems with the accreditation, and the mission came to the regions, and in the regions there are a lot of problems. Those people who were restored through court decisions, they just want to come back to their position, they want to sell positions, to collect money, to cover illegal business. And the mission shows clear priorities. What should be done to change the activity of police, to support communities, to support the interest of people? And this role of the mission will continuously increase. And so after the plan will be adopted and the mandate will continue, there should be an office of mission, not only in big cities and Odessa, Dnipropetrovsk, and maybe other cities, but first we should establish offices there. And the participation and the active role of the mission in training of law enforcers is important to create a service of detectives and also to create basic units of law enforcement and to introduce territorial police, European model of territorial police. And this is one of the components of the mainstream in reforming the national police. And I partly answered your question, maybe. What I wanted to say about your report, this is good job, but I would like to say that I partly disagree with your recommendations provided in your report. First, I feel that there is a wish to direct the mission on all problems that exist in Ukraine, to be omnipresent, and this is unreal. We cannot just put this mission everywhere throughout Ukraine. This mission can help us in some things, not in all. And also, the mission and civil society, they should be the single front, and the mission should and one of the conclusion that they I believe that they should not intervene into politics, and the criminal justice system is too politicized in Ukraine. There are a lot of political assessments that only do harm, and we should not put the mission in this. This is wrong. And law enforcement bodies, they should be out of politics. They should be without politics. They should be in their professional activities only. And the mission can help law enforcers and train them maybe to investigate crimes. This is our biggest problem now, the lack of efficiency in investigation in prosecutor's office and in other law enforcement bodies. So this is what I want to say. And the main is that Ukrainian law enforcers, they should face those challenges and be able to understand what mission provides to them, to implement those principles, those proposals that the mission provides. Thank you. Thank you, Evgeny. Thank you for your advice. And we have 10 minutes. I would like to open Q&A session. And I would like to collect all the questions, and then panelists will answer. Thank you, Vitaly Martynyuk, Center Strategy 2021. With what international organizations and other countries mission cooperate to reform law enforcement sector, and what are the key areas? And do you have any other questions? To Mr. Zakharov, several years ago I spoke with the police officer from Kharkiv, former militiaman, and I spoke to him a lot. We were on a business trip together, and I had an impression that in the system there are two cultures that are in conflict, old culture and new culture. And at that time, I saw that the new culture, he worked in special operation forces that was just created. He took part in the anti-terror operation, and the new culture and the old culture, and they felt like an island of in the sea of old culture. And what is the situation at the moment? Is it the same? And what culture prevails in law enforcement? Those who are old ones or the new ones, who prevails? And I would like to ask Mr. Mueller.
Police education, is it on your agenda? I mean, the old institutions of police education, such as the police academy as it is, because there is a lot of continuities from the Soviet past in terms of both the subject and the manner in which the subjects are taught and the kind of hierarchy which is reproduced through the, I mean, the relations, the human relations kind of patterns, you know, inside the system that are reproduced through the education and which my impression is are very authoritarian and the other way around as opposed to what you have been promoting, the service-oriented approaches, etc.
Дякую. Чи будуть ще запитання? В такому разі, пане Мюллер, прошу до відповіді.
I should say? Okay. Okay. Okay, then allow me to give a reply to your question with regard to the police education. At first, I would like to say the police education will be so essential for the future of the whole police development. So it should be really in the center, it should be in the focus of the high political level, how it will be, how it has to be. Right now, we are also in very close cooperation among the international community, but also, and thankful for that, with the Minister of Interior on this. And it is on a very high, is a very high topic in the ministry, so we are really satisfied with that. The police education in general gives, let me say, even in Europe, we end in particular with our Canadian and American partners. We have, let me say, we have different systems in our countries. So it is a need, let me say, to find an harmonized way how it could be, how it should be in future. And this way has to be dominated by the Ukrainian authorities. What we advised on that is, on one hand, you should go for, or the Ukrainian authorities can go for an educational system which give a really practical and also, if needed, on different levels, high, university education. That means for us, the ordinary patrol officer must have a training which applies to the needs on the streets, which applies to respond and to be sure that he can serve the people. And in our understanding, it couldn't be an issue for, let me say, 1 or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. We have a different understanding about that. We would like to advise go for deeper, basic tactical training. The second level is also very important because the middle management in a police organization is managing everything day by day. And that has also a very deep impact on the service mentality. So we advised as well, that is our recommendation, to go for a bachelor, which is also in line with European standards if it comes to the Bologna process. We assume, we hope, and it will be, that the Ukrainian will become part of the European family. That means also the educational system which applies in Europe could give a direction in which this country can go. And also if it comes to the senior management, then of course you need a very high professional education which is very close to a master education. One crucial point we see in the current situation from our point of view, there is no need to have investigators given a law degree on that. We see it a little bit more different, come from the ground, from the practice on the ground, on the street, and to be developed, be trained, be educated in the system to become different functions in the police. This is really, right now it is very, very serious in the focus of the ministry we know, and we are really happy with that. We are satisfied with that. And also I would like to raise, from our point of view, there's also a strong need that, of course, based on given standards, but that the national police will have the authority to go for in-service training in regional training centers as well. So you see, we see different two lines of responsibility. The general education system, of course, it might be with the ministry. But the training, the in-service training, that might be based on the experience on the ground, might be under the responsibility of the national police. That is, I think that is our international experience, and we would like to advise on this. With regard to the political influence, of course, we wouldn't be influenced. We would like to go to the standards, which give the, let me say, the basic for the service, that we are conserving, that the Ukrainian police and all other law enforcement agencies can serve the people. That is our standard. The standard is developed. We have different standards in Europe, and we would like to advise on that and not on very concrete political issues.
Thank you very much.
Would you like to comment? Yes. Alexander. So now the situation is like this. The team of reformers that introduced reforms, it was really difficult for them. Now the situation is even worse. In 2014, 2015, we felt that the system opposes reforms, and it really is skillful in this. And there was some positive thing. There were some positive things, and there was some development. It's like riding a bike. You should go fast. If you stop, you fall. So they tried to ride fast, and they succeeded. And then, in the result of some subjective and objective reasons that started in 2015 and lasted all 2016, they fell. And the process stopped, and that old culture started to prevail. And even tried to make an offensive, and they want to fire those who carry out reforms. So we should protect reformers. And now I believe that situation starting October becomes better, and I believe that we will have a new start and will be able to carry out quick reforms at National Police. And we have reasons for this, and we have opportunities for this. And I remain an optimist, and I believe in success of this new start that should be really quick. Soon we will feel this. And of course, with great help of the mission. Thank you. And I would like to thank all speakers for their opinions. And our paper is for discussion. That's why all your advice and recommendations will be considered. So reforms in Ukraine are really hard to implement. And last year, we had an event at the end of the year, and people shared their views on some drawbacks of reforms. But I wish everyone not to speak about drawbacks, but to speak about success. And thank you very much, and have a nice day.